On Monday, August 6th, 1945, at 8:15 a.m., the nuclear bomb Little Boy was dropped on Hiroshima by an American B-29 bomber, the Enola Gay. An estimated 130,000 people were killed. On August 9th, 1945, Nagasaki was the target of America's second atomic bomb attack. At 11:02 a.m., the north of the city was destroyed. An estimated 70,000 people died. Over the decades that followed, thousands more died from a variety of radiation-induced diseases, including cancers and birth defects. More than seven decades after these horrifying attacks, citizens around the world remain committed to abolishing nuclear weapons. Winnipeg is one of more than 7,600 cities in 163 countries and regions that belong to Mayors for Peace, an organization that is dedicated to nuclear disarmament. For many years, Winnipeggers have affirmed our commitment to peace and freedom from nuclear terror with a lantern ceremony. The lantern ceremony is part of an ancient Buddhist ceremony called Obon that commemorates the lives of deceased loved ones. For many years around the world, this ceremony has been used on Hiroshima Peace Day to honor and embrace the memory of those who died because of those attacks. During these ceremonies, participants are invited to design a lantern that represents their thoughts and feelings regarding personal losses, global concerns of peace, nuclear disarmament, and any other issue relevant to keeping our planet safe. In addition to lanterns, we make origami peace cranes to commemorate the story of Sadako and the Thousand Paper Cranes. The story briefly goes like this. Sadako Sasaki, a 10-year-old girl, became sick with leukemia from the effects of the atomic bomb in post-war Japan. She believed in an ancient tale that said, if you made 1,000 paper cranes, you would be granted a wish, and she wished for good health. Sadly, she died before finishing making the cranes, and her classmates had to complete the task for her. Each year, thousands of paper cranes from all over the world adorn the statue of Sadako in the Hiroshima Peace Park in Hiroshima.
Today is a very significant date. August 6th is the date of the atomic bomb, the first time ever the people actually faced to that attack, and also the people actually used to the people. And then it's been 73 years since the first atomic bombs attack was happened. And then only 3 days after 1945, August 9th, 1945 was the date of Nagasaki's the Nagasaki's atomic bombs attack. And then that was a very significant attack compared to the other the ordinary or like traditional conventional attack, which was used in Tokyo's air raid or Osaka or Nagasaki or Sendai or anywhere in Japan, to same kind of a damage. The American military air force, they have to use the over 300 B-29 bombings to bombers to attack Tokyo. And in Tokyo, there was a March 10th, 1945. Tokyo was attacked, and then that caused 100,000 people died in the night. And then come to the Hiroshima. There was only one B-29 airplane flew into the Hiroshima and then dropped the one bomb, and then that killed 130,000 people in a second. And then also the because of atomic bomb, those people who survived, or even the people who jumped into the area who got attacked, were died because of the radiation effect. So this is very important to remember why we have to say stop to keep holding those the atomic bombs or the nuclear weapons, and also the people who start creating those stuff to say no to that we should stop doing these weapons to hold or to solve any kind of international issues. So the atomic bombs was it's not even like a comparison nowadays in nuclear weapons. Those the Americans and the Russians, the Indians, and the Chinese who has the or French who has the missiles. One missile is almost like equivalent to the 100 times of the one atomic bomb that dropped in Hiroshima, and the most significantly strong one is it's not. You can't even measure how stronger it is. It's way stronger than the other atomic bombs is. One missile attack could cause the destroyed entire part of the Honshu, the part of Japan, the biggest island. So that's why we are here to remember the World War II and also the those kind of weapons and then disarmament. We're gonna start with the we remember this event using this Japanese traditional ceremony. It's called the lantern ceremony or Todo Nagashi in Japanese, which you use the lanterns and then release into the river. I heard that it used to be in Winnipeg also the release those lanterns into the rivers, and the river represents the sort of like a difference between the actual real world and also the world next to the after you pass away. So doing the releasing the lantern, people were hoping or praying for the people who passed away in the past, and it reached those your thinking of the people who loved in the past, and then they reached to that message to those people. So related to that, so when you release those the lanterns, please remember you're someone who loved or passed away in some tragedy, any disaster or any war, or your grandparents, your great-grandparents who served in the war. And then that's basically the meant for it. You have to pray for it and then remember those kind of tragedies. Okay, so we're gonna start off from
as a gift. My name is Dwayne. I'm shaking up like this. Brother in arms.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're very welcome.
Oh my goodness.
Put it on.
Okay. So I got a gift. It's very special, actually. Thank you. Okay, so I got an additional the friends with me. That's good. Okay, so that's straight off from the Stan Rodzowski, who is going to read City of Hiroshima's mayor's speech. It's actually this kind of a memorial ceremony is happening in Hiroshima right now, and then every year mayor of Hiroshima read the message to the world to basically ban the nuclear weapons and then against the war. So Stan, please come over here and you may read the speech.
73 years ago, on a Monday morning, just like today, with It'll be a little bit easier with my glasses. With the midsummer sun already blazing, Hiroshima starts another day. Please listen to what I say next, as if you and your loved ones were there. At 8:15 comes a blinding flash. A fireball more than a million degrees Celsius releases intense radiation, heat, and then a tremendous blast. Below the roiling mushroom cloud, innocent lives are snuffed out as the city is obliterated. I'm so hot, it's killing me. From under collapsed houses, children scream for their mothers. Water, please, water. Come moans and groans from the brink of death. In the foul stench of burning people, victims wander around like ghosts, their flesh peeled and red. Black rain fell all around. The scenes of hell burnt into their memories, and the radiation eating away at their minds and bodies are even now sources of pain for the Hibakusha who survive. Today, with more than 14,000 nuclear warheads remaining, the likelihood is growing that what we saw in Hiroshima after the explosion that day will return by intent or accident, plunging people into agony. The Hibakusha, based on their intimate knowledge of the terror of nuclear weapons, are ringing an alarm against the temptation to possess them. Year by year, as Hibakusha decrease in number, listening to them grows ever more crucial. One Hibakusha, who was 20, says, "If nuclear weapons are used, every living thing will be annihilated. Our beautiful Earth will be left in ruins. World leaders should gather in the A-bombed cities, encounter our tragedy, and at a minimum set a course towards freedom from nuclear weapons. I want human beings to become good stewards of creation, capable of abolishing nuclear weapons." He asks world leaders to focus their reason and insight on abolishing nuclear weapons so we can treasure life and avoid destroying the Earth. Last year, the Nobel Peace Prize went to ICAN, an organization that contributed to the formation of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. Thus, the spirit of the Hibakusha is spreading through the world. On the other hand, certain countries are blatantly proclaiming self-centered nationalism and modernizing their nuclear arsenals, rekindling tensions that had eased with the end of the Cold War. Another Hibakusha, who is 20, makes this appeal. "I hope no such tragedy ever happens again. We must never allow ours to fade into the forgotten past. I hope from the bottom of my heart that humanity will apply our wisdom to making our entire Earth peaceful. If the human family forgets history or stops confronting it, we could again commit a terrible error. That is precisely why we must continue talking about Hiroshima. Efforts to eliminate nuclear weapons must continue based on intelligent action by leaders around the world. Nuclear deterrence and nuclear umbrellas flaunt the destructive power of nuclear weapons and seek to maintain international order by generating fear in rival countries. This approach to guaranteeing long-term security is inherently unstable and extremely dangerous. World leaders must have this reality etched in their hearts as they negotiate in good faith the elimination of nuclear arsenals, which is a legal obligation under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. Furthermore, they must strive to make the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons a milestone along the path to a nuclear-free world. We in civil society fervently hope that the easing of tensions on the Korean Peninsula will proceed through peaceable dialogue. For leaders to take courageous actions, civil society must respect diversity, build mutual trust, and make the abolition of nuclear weapons a value shared by all humankind. Mayors for Peace, now with more than 7,600 member cities around the world, will focus on creating that environment. Winnipeg, by the way, is a member of the Mayors for Peace. I asked the Japanese government to manifest the magnificent pacifism of the Japanese Constitution in the movement towards the entry into force of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons by playing its proper role, leading the international community toward dialogue and cooperation for a world without nuclear weapons. In addition, I hereby demand an expansion of the Black Rain areas, along with greater concern and improved assistance for the many people suffering the mental and physical effects of radiation, especially the Hibakusha, whose average age is now over 82. Today we renew our commitment and offer sincere consolation to the souls of all A-bomb victims. Along with Nagasaki, the other A-bombed city, and with much of the world's population, Hiroshima pledges to do everything in our power to achieve lasting world peace and the abolition of nuclear weapons. Signed, Kazumi Matsui, the mayor of the city of Hiroshima. Thank you.
Thank you, Stan. Speaking of which, the Winnipeg is one of 7,114 cities in 161 countries that belongs to Mayor of Peace. And next is the Annabella Uehara. We'll read the story of Sadako Sasaki, a girl who became radiation effect sickness after the atomic bomb attack.
The story of Sadako Sasaki. Sadako was 2 years old when the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima. She was 2 kilometers away from where the bomb exploded. Most of Sadako's neighbors died, but Sadako wasn't injured at all, at least not in any way people could see. Up until the time Sadako was in the seventh grade in 1955, she was a normal, happy girl. However, one day after an important relay race, as she helped her team win, she felt extremely tired and dizzy. After a while, the dizziness went away, leaving Sadako to think that it was only the exertion from running the race that made her tired and dizzy. But her tranquility did not last. Soon after her first encounter with extreme fatigue and dizziness, she experienced more incidents of the same. One day, Sadako became so dizzy that she fell down and couldn't get back up. Her schoolmates informed the teacher. Later, Sadako's parents took her to the Red Cross Hospital to see what was wrong with her. Sadako found out that she had leukemia, a kind of blood cancer. Nobody could believe it. At that time, they called leukemia the A-bomb disease. Almost everyone who got this disease died. And Sadako was very scared. She wanted to go back to school, but she had to stay in the hospital where she cried and cried. Shortly thereafter, her best friend, Shizuko, came to her visit her. Shizuko brought some origami folding paper. She told Sadako of a legend. She explained that the crane, a sacred bird in Japan, lives for 100 years, and if a sick person folds 1,000 paper cranes, then that person would soon get well. After hearing the legend, Sadako decided to fold 1,000 cranes in the hope that she would get well again. Sadako's family worried about her a lot. They often came to visit her in hospital to talk to her and to help her fold cranes. After she folded 500 cranes, she felt better, and the doctor said she could go home for a short time. But by the end of the first week back home, the dizziness and fatigue returned and she had to go back to the hospital. Sadako kept folding cranes even though she was in great pain. Even during these times of great pain, she tried to be cheerful and hopeful. Not long afterwards, with her family standing by her bed, Sadako went to sleep peacefully, never to wake up again. She had folded a total of 644 paper cranes. Everyone was very sad. 39 of Sadako's classmates felt saddened by the loss of their close friend and decided to form a paper crane club to honor her. Word spread quickly. Students from 3,100 schools and from 9 foreign countries gave money to the cause. On May 5, 1958, almost 3 years after Sadako had died, enough money was collected to build a monument in her honor. It is now known as a Children's Peace Monument, and it is located in the center of Hiroshima Peace Park, close to the spot where the atomic bomb was dropped.
Thank you. Okay, so the next is the Candace Bodonerk. Did I say it right? Okay. So she's gonna read the part of the book called Hiroshima, written by John Harsey, private reporter's story about this, six survivors from the attack. Candace, please come over here.
Thank you. So this book is a true account of six people who did survive the August 6, 1945 bombing and what they were actually doing at 8:15 a.m. That day when Hiroshima was destroyed. So I'll be reading a passage from the section called The Fire After the Bombing, what happened to Mr. Tanimoto, who was a Methodist minister, his experience that day, and then the other part that's also important with this book is that when this was written on August 31st, 1946, the New Yorker devoted all its space to the story, to the account of the survivors. So, and it was reprinted all around the world in a number of newspapers and also read on air at ABC. But anyway, this is so Mr. Tanimoto's experience directly after the bomb was dropped, and we're at that place in the story. So, Mr. Tanimoto, fearful for his family and church, at first ran toward them by the shortest route along Koi Highway. He was the only person making his way into the city. He met hundreds and hundreds who were fleeing, and every one of them seemed to be hurt in some way. The eyebrows of some were burned off, and skin hung from their hands, faces and hands. Others, because of pain, held their arms up as if carrying something in both hands. Some were vomiting as they walked. Many were naked or in shreds of clothing. On some undressed bodies, the burns had made patterns of undershirt straps and suspenders, and on the skin of some women, since white repelled the heat from the bomb and dark clothes absorbed it and conducted it to the skin, the shape of flowers they had on their kimonos. Many, although injured themselves, supported relatives who were worse off. Almost all had their heads bowed, looking straight ahead, were silent and showed no expression whatever. After crossing Koi Bridge and Cannon Bridge, having run the whole way, Mr. Tanimoto saw, as he approached the center, that all the houses had been crushed and many were afire. Here the trees were bare and their trunks charred. He tried at several points to penetrate the ruins, but the flames always stopped him. Under many houses, people screamed for help, but no one helped. In general, survivors that day assisted only their relatives or immediate neighbors, for they could not comprehend or tolerate a wider circle of misery. The wounded limped past the screams, and Mr. Tanimoto ran past them. As a Christian, he was filled with compassion for those who were trapped, and as a Japanese, he was overwhelmed by the shame of being unhurt, and he prayed as he ran, "God help them and take them out of the fire." He thought he would skirt the fire to the left. He ran back to Cannon Bridge and followed for a distance one of the rivers. He tried several cross streets, but all were blocked. As he turned far left and ran out to Yokogawa, a station on a railroad line that detoured the city in a wide semicircle, and he followed the rails until he came to a burning train. So impressed was he by this time by the extent of the damage that he ran north 2 miles to Gion, a suburb in the foothills. All the way he overtook dreadfully burned and lacerated people, and in his guilt he turned to right and left as he hurried and said to some of them, "Excuse me for having no burden like yours." Near Gianni began to meet country people going towards the city to help. And when they saw him, several exclaimed, "Look, there is one who is not wounded." At Gianni bore toward the right bank of the main river, the Ota, and ran down it until he reached the fire again. There was no fire on the other side of the river. so he threw off his shirt and shoes and plunged into it. In midstream, when the current was fairly strong, exhaustion and fear finally caught up with him. He ran nearly 7 miles, and he became limp and drifted in the water. He prayed, "Please, God, help me to cross. It would be nonsense for me to be drowned when I am the only uninjured one." He managed a few more strokes and fetched up on a spit up downstream. Mr. Tanimoto climbed up the bank and ran along it until near a large Shinto shrine, he came to more fire, and as he turned left to get around it, he met, by incredible luck, his wife. She was carrying their infant daughter. Mr. Tanimoto was now so emotionally worn out that nothing could surprise him. He did not embrace his wife, he simply said, "Oh, you are safe." She told him that she had got home from her night in Yoshida just in time for the explosion. She had been buried under the parsonage with the baby in her arms. She told how the wreckage had pressed down on her, how the baby had cried. She saw a chink of light, and by reaching up with a hand, she worked the hole bigger bit by bit. After about half an hour, she heard the crackling noise of wood burning. At last, the opening was big enough for her to push the baby out, and afterwards she crawled out herself. She said she was now going out to Yoshida again. Mr. Tanimoto said he wanted to see his church and take care of the people of his neighborhood association. They parted as casually, as bewildered as they had met. Mr. Tanimoto's way around the fire took him across the East Parade Ground, which, being an evacuation area, was now the scene of a gruesome review. Rank on rank of the burned and bleeding. Those who were burned moaned, "Misu, misu, water, water." Mr. Tanimoto found a basin in a nearby street and located a water tap that still worked in the crushed shell of a house, and he began carrying water to the suffering strangers. When he had given drink to about 30 of them, he realized he was taking too much time. "Excuse me," he said loudly to those nearby who were reaching out their hands to him and crying their thirst. "I have many people to take care of." Then he ran away. He went to the river again, the basin in his hand, and jumped down onto a sand pit. There he saw hundreds of people so badly wounded that they could not get up to go farther from the burning city. When they saw a man erect and unhurt, the chant began again. "Misu, misu, misu." Mr. Tanimoto could not resist them. He carried them water from the river, a mistake since it was tidal and brackish. Two or three small boats were ferrying hurt people across the river from Asano Park. And when one touched the spit, Mr. Tanimoto again made his loud apologetic speech and jumped into the boat. It took him across to the park. There in an underbrush, he found some of his charges of the neighborhood association who had come there by his previous instructions, and saw many acquaintances, among them Father Kleinsorg and the other Catholics. But he missed Fukai, who had been a close friend. "Where is Fukai-san?" he asked. "He didn't come back. He did not want to come back with us," Father Kleinsorg said. "He ran back." Thank you.
Thank you, Candace. The next will be Ellen Judd from the Winnipeg Quaker meeting. She's going to read about her article, the 73 years after Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And where is Ellen? She's gonna talk about the current situation of the disarmament and stuff too, so it'll be quite interesting, I think.
Thank you, Yuhiro. This has all been tremendously difficult to listen to. I hope we will come away this evening remembering and honoring all those who lost their lives in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and also with a sense of listening to the message of those who survived and what they wish to tell us to do so that we can avoid having anything like this happen again. Following on the mayor of Hiroshima's peace declaration of 2018, I'd like to follow up on some of what he's trying to tell us now. He's talking about how we still live in a world that has been forever changed by the creation and use of nuclear weapons against civilian populations, that were already facing the imminent end of the war, that were far away and appeared to be different, and that this was done as an experiment in the use of two different types of nuclear weapon on human populations. The world's never going to be quite the same after this action. We can also note, more hopefully, that there's been an important forward movement in the past year or so, as endorsed in the mayor's statement in reference to the 2017 Nobel Peace Prize awarded to the International Campaign for the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons. What I'd like to use these few moments for is to talk about the Treaty for the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. This award was granted to recognize the importance of this treaty that was signed on July 7th last year by the United Nations General Assembly, endorsed by 122 countries, and that is already in the process of being signed and ratified. This may seem like a dry topic to discuss, but it's actually something that's incredibly important because it may put us further along the peace to the end of nuclear weapons. What we are now at is a stage in which governments are being asked to come forward to sign this and indicate their willingness to proceed to implement the treaty. And then, following the signatures, or perhaps even without the signatures, the countries involved can undertake the process of ratifying the treaty so that they will then be committed to carrying it out. This is a process that takes a little bit of time, so that we are right now in the midst of this process of making this treaty come into force. The process is going forward quite quickly. If you follow the news lately, you will see that there every few days there's another announcement. We've now reached 60 signatures, Colombia being the most recent, and 14 ratifications, the most recent being New Zealand, both of these within the last week. So this is proceeding extraordinarily rapidly. It is in fact proceeding more rapidly than with any comparable treaty that we know of. What we can do here in Canada is to build a very strong movement for nuclear disarmament that has deep social and institutional roots in Canada, so that we can take Canada through the process of signing and ratifying this treaty. This will be an important national and a global step forward in support of the treaty and the movement toward nuclear disarmament. Now you might ask why this seems so important. And it is, in fact, a fairly sizable task before us. And the reason why this is challenging is that the United States, the United Kingdom, and France have all declared their firm opposition to the treaty and have called upon all the countries with whom they're in military alliance not to be involved with it. None of the nuclear powers have the states that have nuclear weapons participated in any aspect of the treaty process. So what has happened is that Canada has said if the nuclear powers, the countries that have nuclear weapons won't get involved in the treaty process, it doesn't mean anything. So we won't be involved in it either. So what we are faced with now is why we should understand that that is not the case and that it does actually make a difference to be involved in the treaty process. A treaty is not just a document, and if it were just a document, it wouldn't accomplish anything. What a treaty signifies is a threshold in a process of building a movement to accomplish some kind of change. So we can think, for example, to the legacy of World War I and the movement to abolish chemical and biological weapons. Or we can think about the more recent success of establishing with the Landmines Treaty. And in all of these cases, what we are looking at is a long process, or maybe a shorter process, in which we can move towards having an instrument such as a treaty. It is building a movement, gathering support, and bringing something into force. So we have a preparation period, then a threshold where we can accomplish something like a treaty, and then we also have a long process of implementing what has been achieved and maintaining it. So the fact that it isn't going to happen instantly doesn't mean that it isn't important. And the signing itself is an important threshold, but it's perhaps not the thing that we want to look at most. What we see now are several encouraging developments. The first of these is a global movement of close to 500 disarmament organizations that were part of the network that constitutes the international campaign for the abolition of nuclear weapons. and a majority of the states in the United Nations that have joined in this movement to create this treaty, and they have the capacity to access national and international institutions and resources on a large scale. So this is something that is an important asset for the movement toward nuclear disarmament. A second thing that is very important that we are seeing now is a shift in the narrative. So that what we have been told for a very long time is that nuclear deterrence is incredibly important. And the logic behind nuclear deterrence is the idea that we need nuclear weapons in order to prevent other people from using nuclear weapons. Now, if we look at it this way, we're never going to get rid of nuclear weapons. So what we have done now is we're in a moment where we're shifting the narrative so that what we are talking about instead of this is talking about ending mining, testing, and the building of nuclear capacity that leaves us with radiation exposure, to stop doing these things that are harmful, to redirect resources to human needs, and to reduce international tensions. So it's a positive agenda that can lead somewhere rather than a negative agenda that simply keeps perpetuating the use of nuclear weapons. A third thing that is very encouraging for us at this point is that there is a comprehensive push and a move toward negotiation processes toward denuclearization and towards a decrease in international tensions. And certainly we live in a very difficult world right now where it's sometimes a challenge to see hopeful moments. But if we look back in the past year, this is actually one of our better recent years. And one of the things that we can see in this, for example, is what happened in South Korea during the Olympic period and is that we are continuing to see have an impact. And this was an important breakthrough, an initiative by the population, the people of South Korea and President Moon to break through to talking to North Korea to initiate a range of connections between North and South Korea and to move from threats to negotiation and to building relationships between North and South. This is an important step towards the denuclearization of Northeast Asia, bringing peace and security to that area and to the rest of the world. So moving toward conclusion, I would ask, what can we do? And what we can do is to join in the campaign to urge Canada to join in the work towards the Treaty for the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. There's a petition that everybody can sign, and there's a movement underway to try to get 1 million signatures in a short period of time. You can find this very easily by searching for it on the web, or it's the link is on the website of Canadian Voice of Women for Peace and many other places as well. You can join in that petition. You can work with any of the many organizations that are working towards nuclear disarmament. All of the groups that sponsored this evening would be involved in that activity, including Peace Alliance Winnipeg, Winnipeg Quaker Meeting, and the Canadian Voice of Women for Peace. There is no legal obstacle that Canada faces in terms of signing this treaty. Sometimes the impression is created that we're part of NATO or part of the Non-Proliferation Treaty. In fact, those documents both indicate that abolishing nuclear weapons would be a good idea. So we can, in fact, take these steps. There's nothing that stops Canada from doing this. We're certainly under a great deal of pressure. The countries that I just named, in particular the United States and Great Britain, are pressuring their allies, their military allies, not to sign, and these are our close allies. But it's also the case that Canada has resisted this kind of pressure. We haven't had nuclear weapons permanently on Canadian territory since 1984. We didn't send Canadian troops to Vietnam or in 2003 to Iraq. So Canada can, in fact, take these independent decisions, and it doesn't have unbearable consequences for Canada. We simply have to have the strength and the will to do it. We can, in fact, contribute towards building the international institutions, the connections with other countries through signing and ratifying this treaty that helped to bring us closer to nuclear disarmament and towards a more peaceful world. As Setsuko Thurow declared in Oslo in accepting the Nobel Peace Prize on behalf of ICAN, This is the beginning of the end of nuclear weapons. Let it be so, and let us do our bit.
Seven decades after the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the threat of nuclear war still hangs over our planet. Nine countries are known to possess nuclear weapons. These are the United States, Russia, the United Kingdom, France, China, India, Pakistan, North Korea, and Israel. Collectively, they have an estimated 8,000 nuclear warheads and more than 22,000 others in storage. On July 7, 2017, 122 countries voted in the United Nations General Assembly to outlaw nuclear weapons. None of the nuclear-armed nations support this treaty. Further, they and their closest allies refuse to participate in its development. Sadly, this includes Canada. We have to change this. As Canadians, we have a responsibility to our fellow Canadians and to the citizens of the world. Please educate yourself on this issue. An excellent resource is the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. Their website is located at www.icanw.org. There you can learn about the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, where your country stands on the treaty, and what you can do to encourage its adoption. If you're a Canadian, please write to Prime Minister Justin Trudeau and insist that his government support a ban on all nuclear weapons. One voice is unlikely to convince our Prime Minister, however, many will. You can write to Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, House of Commons, Ottawa, Ontario, K1A0A6. No postage is required if mailed in Canada. Furthermore, you can phone his office at 1-613-995-0253 or send him an email, justin.trudeau@parl.gc.ca. Don't stop there. Reach out to your fellow Canadians in person, by email, on social media such as Facebook and Twitter. Urge them to express their support for the UN treaty to ban nuclear weapons. Encourage them to contact their MP and to contact Mr. Trudeau. We really have to get together on this, people.